All right, so let's say hypothetically there are flashlights that are brighter than your 600 lumen Surefire or that insane torch the military has banned because it made it bear deaf or whatever. You know, the one with the ads on the internet. Now, if you've watched this channel and you believe everything I say, which you should because I'm from the government, then you know that my 7200 lumen Meteor and my 9000 lumen Olight X7 are really bright. You know, perhaps because you drank the lumen Kool-Aid and bought those lights too. Or, you know, antifreeze depending on how you look at things. Then there are the special sorts of people out there where there's no such thing as too many lumens, no matter how small of an apartment you live in, how tactical you really are, or how many flashlights you hide from your wife, or husband, or real doll, or, you know, I don't really know your situation. Well, in the race for people who need more lumens, let me introduce you to the new king, or queen, or whatever gender you assign your inanimate objects. The Acebeam X45, a light that can pump out 16,500 lumens depending on which version you choose. I went with the neutral white because, that's what I do. And while Acebeam doesn't say technically if it outputs less, generally cool white versions of lights are brighter than the neutral white options, and they don't list the specs for both. The aluminum-constructed X45 is a 4-LED light using 4 Cree XHP70 quad-core emitters. Acebeam uses an orange peel reflector to help smooth out the beam pattern from those 4 emitters. And it sits behind a coated glass lens. The X45 is powered off of 4 high-drain rechargeable 18650 batteries that are put into a battery carriage slot thing inside the light. Included in the package are 4 high-drain 3100 milliamp hour unprotected cells, a holster, a spare O-ring, and a lanyard, and a manual. To get to the lanyard ring, you'll need a multi-tool plier, at least I did on mine, to twist it, and it pops out. That's what this 90-degree thingamabob means right here. The thing about a flashlight that puts out this many lumens is that there are big jumps in brightness between the modes. So if you're going to buy a 16,500 lumen light and complain about low-end mode spacing, just shut up. Okay? Shut up. Now, while I normally do this on a white wall to allow you to see the brightness jump between levels, the low-end's like under 10 lumens and the high-end's 15,000 lumens, that's not really possible without not being able to see the flashlight. So to accurately portray the mode spacing, we'll do a beam profile shot first so you can see what that looks like for those people into beam shot profiles, and then we'll do it in my basement. I mean, the brightness spacing. First is Firefly. It's very usable and it's very respectable for this sort of light. Then is Low. Then is Mid. Then is High. Then is Turbo. Note that it steps down. Then is Turbo Max, which also steps down. Step downs are necessary in very bright lights because they generate a ton of heat. And this light gets hot on Turbo Max pretty fast. How about that user interface? Like most Acebeams, the user interface is intuitive. I prefer the control ring setup a bit more, like on my K70 or my old K40M, but those add some bulk and length to the lights. Although overly bright lights benefit from extra aluminum to help disperse and shed heat, so I wouldn't complain if this light was just a little bit bulkier, and maybe used a thicker battery tube. With cutouts for a battery like the X7 or the Meteor, versus having a battery carrier. Okay, so put the batteries in the carrier like so. No polarity. Now the carrier itself, when it goes into the tube, doesn't matter which way you stick it through. Tighten it down and you're ready. Press and hold 1 second to go to Firefly. If you hold longer than 2 seconds, you electronically lock out the light. To unlock it, you can always press and hold until it stays in Firefly and it's unlocked. Firefly isn't saved into mode memory. Okay, so turn it off again. Single click turns it on or off. Then press and hold to scroll through the 3 main modes. Low, mid, high, low, mid, high. These are the only three modes saved into mode memory after you turn it off. So whatever the last mode you used was, it comes on in that mode, provided it's, you know, low, mid, or high. To get to turbo, double-click while on. Now to get to turbo max, timing is a little weird. So first you get into turbo by double-clicking. And then when you double-click to get to turbo max, you click it slower. You go click, wait for off click. Basically, click it once, turns off for a split second, and it's black, then click it again. If you double-click it too fast, you won't get it. Again, a fast double-click to turbo, then press, it's black, press, and that's it. So it's a slower double-click the second time. Neither turbo or turbo max are saved into mode memory. When not in use for long periods of time or during transport, make sure you remove the batteries. The LED indicator next to the power button is green. That means you're good. When it turns red, battery voltage is starting to drop, and some of the higher modes will not work correctly. That means it's hit 13 volts. If it turns red, charge your batteries soon after it turns red. A light that has this sort of power needs to be treated a little more carefully. So, oh yeah, strobe. To get to strobe, triple click from on or off for instant tactical dance party. Runtimes. I did most of the runtimes. While this light puts out a ton of lumens, it does function like a regular old flashlight. I used the included batteries for all of my testing. Please note that the cells are unprotected. I did not test it with protected cells. And in the manual, it specifically states that if you don't charge when it gets red, you will damage the batteries, possibly. Now, I did the work for you, and throwing caution to the side, or wind, or whatever you want to call it, I let the light run continuously for several of my tests. I found that when I picked up the light after it cut off for the runtime test, the indicator light was still on, although the light was no longer coming out of the front on some of the boats. Voltage for me was always between 2.48 and 2.52 volts. 2.5 volts is often the minimum voltage recommended for a lot of batteries to keep from damaging them long term. A better safe voltage is about 3.2 to 3.5 for long term health of the battery. 2.5 volts is often the minimum voltage recommended for a lot of batteries to keep from damaging them long term, which in my case, I've found it causes the battery to not charge fully or the battery to not hold consistent charge. I've never had a battery vent or explode, but this is just my anecdotal evidence. So I recommend this light, but only for people that don't forget to turn off their flashlights or charge them when the idiot light on the side turns from green to red. All right, first is Turbo Max. Turbo Max at 30 seconds per FL1 standards is putting out 14,820 lumens. Then at 3 minutes in, it starts to step down and stabilizes at 6 minutes at about 3,600-ish lumens. You see that the green indicator light on the side is on. Green means good, red means charge. On Turbo Max, I measured near the indicator light at 167 degrees Fahrenheit at 3 minutes in. That's freaking hot. So you need to wear gloves to have it feel comfortable if you're holding it and using the Turbo Max for long term. Then at about 53 minutes in, you get the red light, and then it begins its decline in brightness until I cut the test off at 2 hours and 11 minutes. Battery voltage, again, was about 2.48 to 2.5 volts. Then is regular old turbo. At about 9 minutes in, it starts a ramp down to get to about where it stepped down on turbo max mode. At about 57 minutes in, you get the red light, and at about 1 hour and 10 minutes, it starts stepping down. You don't have to immediately charge at the red light, but it's warning you total battery voltage is 13 volts or about 3.2 volts per battery. I let this run one all the way until light stopped coming out at 2 hours and 27 minutes, and battery voltage again was 2.48 to 2.5. Sometimes it was like 2.52 volts per battery. Then, because you and I have nothing better to do, let's get high. I know some people are sick of that one. Then after some time, and at about 1 hour and 20 minutes in, it starts dimming after running pretty steadily with no major brightness step downs. I let it run for a while and dim, and I ended the test at 2 hours and 56 minutes. Voltage was about the same as in the other modes. You get mid. This is the first mode with longer run times, like, you know, if you need to use it for many hours overnight. You get 3 hours and 16 minutes before the red light kicks in. It starts dimming at about 3 hours and 50 minutes, then continues to dim until over 6 hours in, and cuts off at about 6 hours, 38 minutes. Ending voltage was the same as I've mentioned earlier. And for extra punishment, let's get low. Hey, 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 like, anyone else know that one? So you get steady light for about 9 hours and 45 minutes. Red light kicks in, signaling at about 13 volts. Hey, you need to charge. Then it starts dimming a bit later at 11 hours and 15 minutes. Light ceases to come out at 13 hours and 44 minutes. And for this review, I'm doing a new test. Let's see if there's thermal regulation or timed regulation on Turbo Max. Here's my phone with my timer and my lux meter. So basically, they should step down at around the same time if there is timed regulation. Thermal regulation, when a cooling fan is on it, should take longer. It's not super scientific. One has a fan on it, the other doesn't. But both do seem to start dimming around the same point. I noticed about a 15 to 20 degree temperature difference at 3 minutes in, 165 on the non-cooled Fahrenheit and 145 Fahrenheit for the cooled one. Both stabilize at about 7-ish minutes into the same brightness. Again, at this point, you're still pretty hot at about 150-ish degrees near the switch and 120-ish near the tail cap. If you want to run this for more than a few minutes on its max brightness mode, bring gloves. You'll be fine if you use it in bursts under 2 minutes without gloves, you know, or you're in a colder climate. Or just use one of the lower modes. Okay, now the beam shots. Here are the lights I'll be comparing the X45 to. That's right, a few of the brightest lights out there. A few other ace beams and a context light. A context light is a light I'll say is about 1,000 lumens, maybe a little less, because that's what most people are familiar with as being a bright flashlight. Since our eyes are more sensitive to light than my camera, this will help give perspective. Okay, first is my context light, the Xtar B20 Pilot. OG subscribers will remember this video and may not like it. The jokes haven't improved, but the quality cameras and testing all have. Now is the X45 in Turbo Max. The context light will help give it some wow factor. My X45 puts out a little less than 15,000 lumens. I assume that's because the neutral versions always put out less than the cool white versions. Expect the cool white, in theory, to get closer to 16,500 lumens, and I have no reason to doubt that because I own several Acebeams, and you can watch those reviews for my testing to see how well they match up. Now is the X45 in just puny turbo mode. I got more about 7,000 lumens and 9,000 lumens. I'm not sure why that is, but who cares? Remember, for our eyes to perceive something to be twice as bright, it really needs to be four times as bright. That's why it may not seem like much of a difference, but it really is. The figures on screen for all the lights are my tested figures. I will go back to the Turbo Max mode before moving on to the Olight X7, which is my brightest light, was my brightest light, but is now my second brightest. It has a cool tint, and I prefer the more neutral Acebeam tint. And the Acebeam tint, by the way, is kind of yellowish, not quite creamy. They say it's about 5,000K. But I think it's a little less than that. The X45 on paper is currently the brightest production light. The 47's Maelstrom, I don't know how you say it, was 15,000 lumens, but that's discontinued, and the Immolent DT70 is 16,000 lumens. Now, I know my X45 is under 15,000 lumens, but remember, I'm testing using the neutral white version, and my testing equipment isn't professionally calibrated. You've seen the video, right? Now to the Noctigon Meteor, the most compact of my big lumen lights, with a nice neutral tint. This one's probably a little more around 5,000K. And the video responsible for almost a third of my channel views, for better or worse. Now back to the X45 for a few seconds, before moving on to another Acebeam, the K70. The Acebeam K70 is my throwiest light still, meaning the highest candela. It will shine light much further into the distance than the X45. Even though it's only a fraction of the brightness. The X45 is much floodier, but still no slouch and throw, partly due to its immense lumen pumping power. Now the Acebeam EC50. Now I'm basically using this in case you also bought this light from another one of my videos, just showing you how much of an upgrade this light in brightness is over that one. Now back to the X45 for a few seconds. Yeah, before going to my custom Adventure Sport Flashlights Maglite. Yeah, that's right, nearly a 5,000 lumen Maglite. The floodiest big lumen light I have by a long shot. The floodiest being the keyword. If you want to disperse bright light, this is about as floody as you can get. My autocorrect is saying bloody, but that video should be out soon. Maybe it'll be out before this video. I'm just waiting for fellow flashlight channel Adventure Sport Flashlight to give me the go-ahead to publish my video. Back to the X45, and let's wrap this up. Is this going to be my longest flashlight review? I sure hope not. For my sake and your sake. Now, most people have no need for this bright of a light, but I review these things because I have a defect in my brain, and I like big bright lights. Hopefully you have that defect too. Or maybe your defect is exotic blade steel. Price on this light is about $250 to $300 depending on where you get it, which isn't that bad when you do some lumen per dollar math, especially if you have a Surefire as your reference light. A little flashlight humor for people who understand that. And someone else is like, those are fat words! Acebeam continues to prove they can push the envelope and max lumens and throw. Again, this may soon change, but this is on paper the brightest production flashlight that I'm aware of. Now, there are brighter custom lights, and Vin makes brighter versions of this particular light. And maybe there are some specialty spotlights, but you get the idea. Like, major flashlight brands, as in like Nikkor, Surefire, Olight, etc. This is the brightest, at least for a few weeks or a month or whatever. The light is waterproof to IPX8 standards, so use it in the rain and elements, and temporary shallow submersion in water is also okay, provided your O-rings are lubed and you don't disassemble the light. And you know what? It's actually kind of compact, you know, relatively speaking, technically. And finally, no visible PWM was observed on any modes by me, my camera, or my imaginary friend who follows me around everywhere, but no one else can see. Acebeam provided this light for testing and review. If you like this review, stay tuned for reviews of the best lights out there, or at least some of the most interesting. Subscribe, give the video a thumbs up, leave a comment. Thanks for watching.